Director, do you have figures now? Because you did say that the elections was generally peaceful. Do you have figures now as to how many were actually killed or were injured as a result of the elections yesterday?
Okay, for the validated election-related violence which resulted into deaths, we have 29 of them.
29. These are deaths, just to confirm, Director.
29 incidents resulting into 19 deaths, and we have 113 others which not necessarily resulted into deaths, but are incidents which are still being validated.
And how many injuries?
For the injuries, for the confirmed injuries related to the elections, 19. 19.
Only 19 injuries. So 19
19.
deaths
Confirmed. 19
confirmed.
deaths, 19 confirmed injuries related to elections. As to those still being validated, then again, we have 113 incidents resulting into, I have to add the figures up, but it's a much larger than 30. These are still being validated, and we'll have to get back to you on this.
How would you compare this, Director, to the previous elections? 29 seems to be, or 19 deaths. The other watchdogs, for example, the Council for Climate and Conflict Action in Asia, recorded 11 deaths just in Guam alone and 25 injuries. How would you compare this with the previous record in previous elections?
Despite these figures being a cause for concern for public, of course, as much as possible, we don't want these incidents to happen. This is still quite low and compared to 2018. Coming from the previous elections, so we have 300 plus incidents resulting into less than 100 deaths. Right now, it's still quite low, but again, this is a cause for concern, and we really have to improve this situation. We have to explain to the, you know, it's have to normalize elections to the people that it must not result into any form of violence. This is a village elections. People who are voting for are they know who are they voting for. They are kapitbahays, as we have been telling this our people. These are kapitbahays, kakilala, kababayan, kababata. This should not result into violence.
On the other hand, Director Laudianco, some would argue that because this is a very personal election, so you know each other, you could be rivals. In fact, one of the killings actually was supposedly between siblings in the Barm region. So some would say this would in fact be a heated election because of the personal ties.
We had really expected that. We expected that the first barangay and SK elections will have much more tension. It will be more heated. But then again, at the end of the day, we're telling them, all of you intended to run to serve your communities. This is a village election. That's why there's no political parties here, because the relationship should be much more personal. The campaign period is less because you should know each other. And that's why having the intention to serve each other, it should not really result in the violence. That's why we are pleading to our people last night to accept the results of the elections. Their kabarangays have already voted and spoken, and therefore we should respect that.
Director, can we get more information about these 19 deaths that you said have been confirmed? Where did this happen? Which areas did this take place?
Most of these took place again in the Bangsamoro autonomous region in Muslim Mindanao. That's really the region which has the most tension and the most red area of concern, as we have declared.
And who are these people killed? Are these candidates? Are these supporters? Are these ordinary voters? Do you have a breakdown of the 19?
I don't have the exact figure right now, but involved are relatives of the candidates. Most of those skills are either supporters or relatives of candidates.
And do we have a candidate that was killed?
We do have that. We have that.
Can we confirm if that was the one in Lanao del Norte, or is it in any other area?
It's in another area, I think. I'll get back to you on that. I don't have the name yet. But definitely one of the candidates was killed.
Now, the CCAA, that's monitoring the Barm region, they've also recorded at least, or not less than 45 fistfights or commotion or gunfights in the Bom region alone. How would you explain this, Director? Are there not enough security in place in these places for fistfights, commotions to actually take place?
As we all know, the number of the law enforcement and security personnel really cannot match the mass of people going into the schools. We only have a limited number of them, despite Bom having the highest number and the concentration of the deployed law enforcement and security personnel. These things really do happen. We cannot guard each and every voter and each and every candidate. But one thing that is good here is that in each of the flashpoints, the law enforcement and military personnel were readily there. They're there. They were able to respond immediately. And in most instances, they were able to apprehend the perpetrators. In fact, those very significant events in Lanao del Norte, where some of the voters engaged in fistcuffs with the police personnel, we were able to apprehend them. The two incidents in Dato Odins in Suwat, the last one, the almost 50 men barged into a polling place with bolos, all 50 of them got arrested. So in each and every incident, our law enforcement and security personnel were able to pacify the situation and were able to bring those injured to the hospitals and most importantly, arrest the perpetrators, immediately brought them to the National Prosecution Service, have cases filed against them by an inquest.
All of these incidents, Director, have been resolved and some have been arrested in all of these incidents?
Not resolved yet because cases have been filed, but in every instance, a perpetrator has been arrested.
And what happened to the burning of ballots in Puerto Princesa? Yesterday, one was supposedly arrested. Have there been developments in that particular case?
The other two persons involved in there are still being identified by the PNP. But one good thing that happened there, just immediately after the incident, polls continued and resumed. Mm-hmm. We had taken out some of the ballots from the other precincts and we used them to continue the voting in that particular precinct in Pilot Elementary School in Puerto Princesa.
So no failure of elections, whether in Puerto Princesa or any other part of the country, Director?
No failure of elections. Even that incident in Dato Odins in Suwat where people barged in, still we were able to proceed with the elections and encourage the people to go back to the school and vote.
Mm-hmm. Now, Director, moving forward, what are the steps that will be taken by COMELEC to prevent violence during the polls?
Of course, the first thing that we will do is enhance our security template for this. We already know where the flashpoints are, and we must anticipate more flashpoints in the coming BSKE because people really now are so engaged in the barangay and SK elections, unlike before, that they don't mind the low voter turnout for BSKE. Right now, people really are indeed participating in BSKE. That's why, aside from the security template, we will be enhancing our preparations for the voter information so that people will know the processes. One thing that heated up the situation yesterday was that immediately after the counting, the teachers were supposed to bring back the ballot boxes to the municipal and city treasurer's offices. But in some schools, voters prevented them from doing so, not knowing that the counting was already done. The ERs, the election returns, had already been submitted to the barangay boards of canvassers. And then the next thing to do is to bring back the ballot boxes. We have to explain to the people that this is the process, the counting is done, and we should let our teachers and members of the electoral boards perform their jobs after this.
On that aspect, Director, were there not efforts to actually inform the people as the process of these elections? Because there were some changes that you implemented. Were there not efforts to actually explain to them what happened?
These processes have been explained. These processes are contained in the resolution. The problem is that in heated areas, the voters and the candidates themselves are so suspecting of any move that the teachers queuing the ballot boxes in one of the rooms, readying them for transportation, was a cause for suspicion. We really have to explain to them that this is a normal process. The teachers would have to do that for efficiency so that they could go all together to the municipal and treasurer's offices instead of them going there one by one. So each and every move was being suspected despite having this explained, having been explained to them, despite having all these processes laid out in our resolutions.
And Director, one last item on this, a prevailing problem that has been persisting throughout most elections, vote buying. Lente reported that 95% of the complaints they received 3 days prior to the elections were on vote buying. Where are you in terms of trying to stop vote buying? I know that you presented some figures yesterday. Where are we in terms of filing more cases?
You can expect the filing of more cases for those who haven't been proclaimed yet. We are now gunning for the filing of petitions for disqualification. But if we cannot do that already because of the regulatory periods, we will still continue with the filing of election offense cases for these. We are looking at more than 200 plus cases for vote buying. This is significantly less than in 2019, in 2022, and especially in 2018. No more of those large-scale use of the online platforms, because we had informed them that the BSP and the Anti-Money Laundering Council, including these platforms, GCash and PayMaya, had been cooperating with COMELEC and ready to give us the data in case these platforms are used for vote buying.
What about more, say, creative ways of vote buying? There were reports that Lente received of subsidies or, in fact, aids that were supposedly withheld and will be given only after elections. Are you looking into that?
Yes, we are. And that's the reason why for 10 days we had suspended the assistance for individuals in crisis situation, ramped up and make it even more regimented, the distribution of social services by barangays. Actually, we haven't approved any application for any of the barangay who will be making assistance or social services during the campaign period, just to ensure that this cannot be used as a means for vote buying.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Director John Rex Laudianco from the Commission on Elections.
Maraming salamat po.